Praise Life Ministries, we enjoy reading. Each month, our pastors choose a book and designate the entire month for reading it. We like to call this the Book of the Month. This is a great tool for you to go to the next level. Reading is an investment in yourself, and that's why here at Choose Life Ministries, we are prioritizing the Book of the Month. You can purchase this month's book at the Filling Station Bookstore by visiting in-store or view other options on the screen for more ways to purchase your book.
Make sure to grab a book review guide at the Connect Center. Turn it in to be entered into the quarterly $500 giveaway.
Leaders are readers. Start a book club with your friends and family today.
Hello, we are the Kings. My name is Florence King.
And I'm James King. We have been attending Choose Life Church for a year and 1 month so far. We took Growth Track because it was part of us being a part of the church family, and we wanted to follow all the rules that was required for us to be where we are today, a part of the family. The other people should take Growth Track because Growth Track, it helped us because it let us find out what was required, what our pastor and the family stood for, the principles of God. It's based on the Word of God, so Growth Track just puts you right in the path to succeed.
Right. It changed me in so many different areas, giving me confidence in myself, more confidence in myself, and just getting deeper in the Word, you know, learning how to get deeper in the Word, and then the tools, all the tools that we get. It's awesome. And I mean, I'm able to see myself more and dig into God's Word more. I'm finding out who I am, you know, more. And so, I mean, He's doing great things for our lives. And I mean, I couldn't ask for more. So,
Growth Track did all that for you?
Yeah.
Okay. All right, then. Growth Track for me, it just gave me direction.
Yeah.
You know, we are from a church background, and it just gave us clarity. And I'm thankful that we took it and we're involved and we're growing and we get a chance to grow with Pastor Dean, Pastor Kathy, and the rest of the staff, and just to be a part of something great, which we always wanted.
It would change your life big time. And I'm trying not to cry because it's done so many different things for me, because if you only knew the place that I came from and where I am now, I just praise God for this church. I just praise God for it.
I recommend Growth Track for direction.
Yeah.
You know, coming into a church, knowing what the pastor stands for, knowing the direction that the church is going, knowing what's required of you, getting an opportunity that in Growth Track to, if you don't know what your gifts are, find what your gifts are, find where you fit in, and who doesn't want to fit in?
Right.
So, I mean, to me, if you want to really fit in, go to Growth Track.
Yeah.
Deep Bible Training Center began in August of 2007 with a vision to disciple those who truly want more. Taking 2 hours each Monday night would help establish a firm foundation in the life of a believer, a life truly built on the rock of God's Word. It provided time to really disciple believers and impart wisdom and knowledge beyond what's available during a church service. Each year, Deep Bible Training Center has grown in size, and the testimonies of what Deep has done for individuals and families is absolutely priceless. We have found that devoting extra time each week to studying the Word of God catapults believers' relationship with God. They build a solid ground that no storm or situation can break. With classes on honor, finance, and health, and authority, and many, many more, believers graduate with revelation and knowledge to equip them to be overcomers and stand strong on the rock of God's Word. So far, we've had over 550 Deep Bible Training Center graduates, over 550 people whose lives were forever changed. Will you join? Will you be the next one? The next one in a history of students who drew a line in the sand and determined to dig deep and build a life that would withstand time and trial. After 15 years, one thing we know for sure: discipleship eliminates every problem. Partnering with DSM gives you an opportunity to invest into the kingdom of God and help people step into all that God has for them. The seed you sow in Dean Shropshire Ministries will produce a great harvest.
Groundwork is a ministry of Choose Life Church's Single Life, preparing individuals who would like to begin dating God's way. This 16-session course is going to prepare you with the tools necessary to be led by the Spirit in embarking on one of the most significant journeys, marriage. At Choose Life, we believe that doing things God's way always produces amazing fruit that lasts forever.
More. We thank you for exponential growth. We thank you for multiplication of lives, the 30% increase in every way, the 30% in growth, in personal growth, in the development of us as we follow you, Father. But then from that development, everything that you've called us to, it begins to increase supernaturally, and we thank you for it.
What you do privately is translated publicly. And you're either translating publicly light or darkness. Private will be translated publicly, and it will be translated exactly the way it is. How it is in private is how it's going to be translated in public. Private isn't private.
Everybody, I'm Kathy Shropshire. Welcome to Victory, the Road to Success.
By the way, here in the struggle, your love's enough to wash it all away. On the third day, yeah, you rose up and you beat death once and for all. Once and for all.
No! step of the way. Here in the struggle, your love's enough to wash it all away. On the third day, yeah, you rose up and you beat death once and for all.
From the dead.
It's time for the church to get strong again.
Then all of heaven rejoices with us.
Together with people who believe that God is good, who still believe the Bible, who still believe in the yes. Holy Ghost. Aren't you glad Hallelujah. To be alive for such a time as this? Aren't you glad to be saved, to be delivered, to be healed, to be more than a conqueror in Christ Jesus? And listen, if you didn't know that tonight, or you didn't know that to be true, you're going to know that tonight. Say, I believe.
I receive
exactly what I need
exactly.
For this hour.
I'm overcoming
by the blood of the Lamb,
by the blood of the Lamb,
and the word of my testimony. Hallelujah. Come on, let's praise the Lord in this place. Hallelujah. We magnify you, God. You are so great. You are greatly to be praised. Be exalted in this place. We know that you inhabit our praises, and we love you, Lord. We love your word. We love your house. We love your plan. You are good. There is none. we feel your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Hallelujah.
Wanting a place to in the house of the Lord tonight? Hallelujah. Well, then you're in the right place. And if you are here with us for the very first time, welcome to Choose Life Church. Can we give our first-time guests a great big round of applause? We're so honored you're here with us for our 36th anniversary conference. Also, if you're here with us online, thank you for being with us. Let's give them a great big round of applause as well. We are so excited you are here. We're honored to have Dr. Jerry Savelle in the house tonight. Praise the Lord. If you are here for the first time, we would love the opportunity to connect with you. We have two Connect Centers out in the lobby. We would love for you just to stop by, mention that it's your first time. We want to celebrate you as our guest, and we'd also like to give you a gift tonight.
Yes, take a seat really quick. We're going to jump back into a time of praise before we have Dr. Jerry Savelle share with us. But I just want to give you three real quick, right out of the gate, anniversary announcements. First of all, if you don't have one of these booklets and you would like one, this is going to give you the dip. This is going to give you the skinny about Choose Life Church. If you'll just raise your hand, the sanctuary host in your section would love to put one in your hands. We put one of these out every year. It highlights all of our ministries, every way that you can connect and get involved, from the youngest partner to the oldest partner. We want you to continue to choose life and learn to walk by faith and experience God's abundant plan for you in every area of your life. So keep your hand up. They're moving. Also, they're going to put on the screen right now. We did a special offering at the direction of Dr. Jesse on Wednesday night. And if you would like to give towards that digitally, we had to set up for Pastors Dean and Kathy a Cash App and a Venmo account. They didn't have that before. And so look at them moving on up into the 21st century. So if you didn't get a chance to take a picture of that and you would like to have that for this use or future use, we just want to make sure that you have the opportunity to see that. And also in the lobby, there's a wagon there with some cards. If you would like to leave a note of thanks to Pastors Dean and Kathy, just say one thing that you're grateful to them for, maybe something that God's done in your life through their ministry. I know that would bless them. This is a special time that we not only honor what God has already done, but the gifts that he's given us. That's such a big deal. He wouldn't have given them to us if we didn't need them. And honestly, like, we have the very best that honor us with their presence. They have a lot of things on their plate. They have a lot of places they can go. And God always blesses us with the very best, not just our pastors, but with incredible men of faith. And we're so blessed to have Dr. Jerry here and to have had Dr. Jesse here. It's a high honor, and I know that you guys don't take it lightly. But then again, like I said, opportunity for you to give your thanks to Pastors Dean and Kathy. That's at the wagon. Grab a card. Teenagers, I know y'all always have the best words. Y'all are the best encouragers. So don't sleep on that opportunity. I know there's going to be a lot of fun things in the lobby, but make sure you share. Some people are words of affirmation.
That's right.
Right? We want to love our pastors in every way possible.
Now's your chance. Let it rip.
Now's your chance.
Also, we want to let you know we are doing a giveaway at the end of service tonight. So if you didn't get a ticket at the doors when you came in, be sure to stop by and get one of those. We want you to be a part of that giveaway.
Yes, co-op registration is this coming Monday. Everyone say tax day.
Tax day.
We tried to make it simple for you guys. Same day taxes are due is the day that you have the opportunity to register your kindergartner through 12th grader for co-op that's starting in the fall. We want you to take advantage of that. You can stop by any of the Connect Centers or the co-op booth in the lobby. We've got new gear available for them. And take advantage of that. Ask questions. There's a staff member there. If you didn't already know, our original building that God blessed us with when this church started has now been completely renovated, and we use it for a homeschool co-op. Aren't you grateful? Aren't you grateful that your kids have a place? If you have the ability to homeschool, that's great. But there's still a place and an opportunity for them to still get up. You know what I'm saying? Like, get up every day and have to get dressed and be accountable to other people and not just their teacher mom and their teacher dad. So we're here for you, and it's a great, great school. It's got some incredible leadership, many of which I'm joined with on this praise and worship team, and they do a phenomenal job. They do a phenomenal job. This amazing woman to my right is the director, and she does a phenomenal job. And so I'm telling you, you should not go into that opportunity lightly. You should not sleep on that, because there is so much more to be afforded your kids than even just the education. So there's details about that in the lobby. And then last thing for me, don't forget to register, ladies, for our women's conference happening April 30th through May 4th. All the details are on our app, but that's an exciting time just for the ladies 15 and up. We've got a lot of special things planned for you, so you don't want to neglect that opportunity.
That's right. Also, we want to let you know Deep College Weekend is coming up Monday, April 22nd, so you can be a part of Deep on Monday nights. It is from 7 to 9 p.m. and it is one of the discipleship arms of this ministry. And we're so thankful that people have the opportunity to come and build their life on the Word of God. So that includes those of you that are here in person, even deep extended fields. We're excited to open this up for you to see what it's all about. Then also, LBI, which is Life Bible Institute College Weekend, taking place May 6th and 7th. So come be a part of that. You can register for both of these on the Choose Life app, or if technology is not your thing, just stop by one of the kiosks out in the lobby, and one of our lobby hosts will be glad to help you get signed up to be a part of Deep College Weekend or LBI.
Yeah, and if you are, again, new to Choose Life, you don't have our app, or you don't know how to find us online, we're in here. Find out all of our details, where you can find us online, our YouTube channels, all of those things. And if you are with us online, that'll help you so much to get connected in that way. We're so glad. Gosh, God is good. I'm so grateful to be alive in this hour. Don't you know that He saved the best for last? The Bible says the glory of the latter rain will be greater than the former. Man, you read the Bible, some great things happen, but it's better now. Come on, say it's better now. Say, I've got a new covenant, and I'm taking advantage of all of it. Say it again, I've got a new covenant, and I'm taking advantage of all of it. Well, stand to your feet. Let's praise the Lord. Let's celebrate the great life of faith that we have in Him. Amen.
Lift your name up high.
Come on.
see the other side. We're going to occupy till it comes.
Let it be done right here as it is there. He paid for us to have His life in this life. And no one can keep us from it. Amen? So don't you get in the way of you. You keep doing what you know to do. And you'll find yourself living the life of God. Amen? Zoe, life as God has it. It belongs to us. I don't care who talks about plan B through plan Z. We're going to deal only with plan A. Plan A is that we are victorious, we're overcomers, we're healed, we're flush, we're blessed. Everything we put our hand to. If you're going to have what you say, you want to say what God says. Amen? Hallelujah. I love you a bunch. Give a couple of people a hug and sit down. Thank you, Lord. I know that Dr. Jerry can attest to this, as many of us in the room can. Time flies when you're about the Father's business. I mean, it flies when you're about the Father's business. And what's even better than that is it is a great time. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Sad days are gone. And glad days are here. Amen. We can choose to walk and live in the joy of the Lord. As Dr. Jerry has talked about for years, we can walk in the favor of the Lord, or we can complain, or we can moan or groan. But it's better to walk in the favor of God. Amen. Hallelujah. Glory to God. I want to look at a few verses here. I want to give you an opportunity to sow tonight. We're definitely going to bless Dr. Jerry. We would love for you to be a part of that, give you an opportunity to sow. This is a tried and tested ministry. This is your 55th year? This 55th year, you know? Hallelujah. That's a big deal. Now, I could stand up and brag on him for quite a while. He probably doesn't even know that I could brag on him, or that I would brag on him. But he's someone that you can actually brag on. He's someone that has done exactly as the Spirit of God told him to do, continued to do what he's doing, preaching faith, teaching faith, going around the world, being a blessing, being a helper and not a hater. I'm just trying to follow after somebody like that that'll be a helper and not a hater, because it's so easy to be a hater in a day and time when there are so many haters. And it seems like that's the only thing that haters understand, is you hating on them a little bit. But the bottom line is, he has a great, great, great track record in the kingdom of God. He's worthy of anything we're able to do for him, pray for him, get connected with his ministry. Whatever you do, do it knowing that he's going to bring honor and glory to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. In Galatians chapter 6, verse 6 through 10, Paul said, "Let him that is taught in the word communicate or give or partner with him that teaches in all good things. Be not deceived, God is not mocked. For whatsoever a man sows, that shall he also reap. For he that sows to his flesh shall of the flesh reap corruption. But he that sows to the Spirit or the things of God shall of the Spirit reap life everlasting. And let us not be weary," 55 years, "and let us not be weary in well-doing. Let us not be weary in well-doing, for in due season we shall reap," not might reap, could reap, or should reap, "we shall reap if we faint not." I'm going to tell you, there's nothing reserved for quitters. There's nothing reserved for those that give up. There's nothing reserved for people who don't continue. Just like Jesus told those Jews that believed on him that day, he said, "If you'll continue in my word, sure enough, you'll be my disciples. And you'll know the truth, and the truth will make you free." Don't grow weary. Don't let somebody keep you from what belongs to you. Don't let an offense, an issue, a problem, something that happens in your life or someone else's life, don't let it stop you. There's nothing more important than you staying connected to the Word of God as it pertains to the promises that He has for you. And then in verse 10, I want you to look at yourselves, each other, those of us that are in this house tonight. I want you to look at yourself differently. "As we have therefore opportunity, let us do good unto all men, especially," say especially, "especially unto them who are of the household of faith." Now, there are lengthy definitions of that particular verse all by its lonesome. But the bottom line is this: not every people are the same. Not every church attendee is the same. There are a special breed of church people. And I don't want to develop some exclusive clique, but I'd like to call them just what he says they are, the household of faith. You know, there's a difference between believing believers and unbelieving believers. There's a difference between men and women who don't understand that faith is not the name of your organization or the name of the people you follow, but it's your opportunity to get connected with God in a vital way, not just financially, but in every area. We talked about it a little bit last night. Without faith, it's impossible to please God. So it's not really optional. If you're going to be successful as a child of God, you're not only going to walk in faith, you're not only going to continue to do the things that the Spirit of God tells you to do, but you're going to help others. You're going to be a blessing to others. And we've talked about it. We've talked about it a lot recently. That's why God has been able to do with us what he's been able to do. Because we know how important it is that we continue to stay together, work together, and believe God together. He said he's a rewarder. Those that know he is God, he is a rewarder. And he will allow you to continue to be blessed. Because what's he going to do? He's going to be rewarder of those who diligently seek him. I don't know what your definition of diligently is, but mine's pretty much you stay humped up. You stay focused on him. He is the author. He is the finisher. And all we need to do is let him be the in-betweener. Let him just take over. Let him take over. Amen. And so as you honor God in your giving, please realize that it's a big deal to be a part of a real household of faith. Men and women who are actually endeavoring to walk in and to enjoy the things that Jesus paid for. Honestly, that brings him great honor. It brings him great honor when we make a decision that come hell or high water, we're going to continue to focus on him. Or if somebody tries to talk us out of something, we're going to act like we're one of the three Hebrew boys. We're not going to bow. We're not going to bow to some wicked agenda, whether it's a religious agenda or a secular agenda. The only one we're going to bow before is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And he's the only one that we're going to stand before. Please remember, he is the one that we'll stand before. It is he that we will give an account of what we've done in this life. So we're to love one another, but your first focus is to love him with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. If you need an envelope for giving, there's one in the seat back in front of you, check or cash. If you're giving electronically, the information will be on the overhead. I'll give you an opportunity to sow tonight. We're excited about what God's done. These last couple days went pretty stinking quick. Of course, 2 days don't take long, you know. But we're really honored to have Dr. Jerry with us. Amen. Praise God. Father, in Jesus' name, we're so grateful. We're so grateful for your plan. It's your plan. None of us in this room had anything to do with your plan. We've just been assigned the opportunity to learn about your plan, to walk in your plan, to enjoy your plan, to continue to pass your plan on to others. Thank you that we have an opportunity to do that. Thank you that as he is, so are we in this life, here to make a difference, glory to God. Thank you for everyone that sows. Father, I believe you receive their gifts as a worship unto yourself. In Jesus' name, amen. Go ahead and receive, please.
I'm blessed in the field, I'm blessed going out, and I'm blessed coming in.
Hallelujah. Eric, if you'll come up, please. Just welcome this young man right here.
Thank you.
Good evening, everybody.
Good evening.
It's good to be with you in Hobbs as it is in heaven, New Mexico. Well, I'm Eric. I'm an associate, Brother Jerry. We travel all over the world, and it's good to be here with you tonight. We have a resource table in the back. And how many of this is your first time to hear Dr. Savelle in person? Well, all right, quite a number of you. Where have you been?
I know, huh?
Well, if you don't know his ministry, he's known as Mr. Favor or Dr. Favor all over the world. Sometimes people introduce him that way. And just to tell you a little bit about Favor, we're blessed, and he teaches that the blessing empowers us to prosper, and favor opens the doors or gives us opportunities for the blessing to go to work. And so here's some things about favor. Supernatural increase and promotion. Does that sound good to anybody? Yes. Recognition of everything, or restoration of everything that the enemy has stolen. Honor in the midst of your adversaries. Great victory in the midst of great odds. And I like this one, preferential treatment. Just recently, we were in Birmingham, Alabama, and there's a men's store that he likes to go to that sells fine men's clothing, and he's one of the best dressed preachers in the world. So I try to keep up with him the best I can. And so we went in there, and he's picking out a couple of things. Well, I see the sale rack, 50% off. And they happen to have my size in an Italian suit called Canali. That's a nice suit. So I put it on, and I went to the mirror, and I tried it on, you know, and it didn't fit exactly right, but the price tag was 50% off. So I was like, you know, $1,250, that's favor. Didn't fit exactly right. So I put it back. I'm thinking about it, and he's already at the counter. He said, you see anything you like? I said, yeah, but didn't fit exactly right. So anyway, we walked out, and so we went to the church that night, and they gave him a gift card to that same men's store. So guess where we went the next day? Back in the men's store. I went straight for the sale rack again. Now listen to this. You hang out with Dr. Favor, it's called increase by association. But this will work for anybody if you just understand what favor is. So I go back to there, to this, and I looked at the sticker price again. It had been marked down since yesterday from $1,250, which was 50% off, to $400. So I tried it on, went to the mirror, fit perfectly. I went to the counter, I said, they said $400 for a Canali suit. Wow, this must be a mistake. I said, that's a favor of God is what it is. We went back to the ministry and told the pastor the testimony and told the church, and the pastor said this, I know the owner of that store personally. I have never got a Canali suit for that price. We said, you're hanging out with the wrong people. You got to hang out with Mr. Favor. That's just part of preferential treatment that God does for us as the body of Christ when we walk in the favor of God. So what we come to do is when we recognize it, we say, hey, that's the favor of God. So we experience it every day. Surrounds us with favor as with a shield. So every day when we walk outside, we experience the favor of God. And it can happen for you, but you got to understand what it is. Amen. So that's back there. And then when Dr. Savelle and Miss Carolyn were young, in the ministry, and he was listening to Oral Roberts on television, and he said, you can write for my free book, The Miracle of Seed Faith. And he said, Carolyn, this is one we can afford. Write in for it. And so this is the book where Dr. Savelle talks about how he learned how to make God his source. Now, someone that's been in the ministry for 55 years, if they say that this is the book that you know, how God taught them to be, or how they learned how God to be their source, then I would definitely check that out. Amen. And this is one that a lot of people don't know about. If Satan can't steal your dreams, he can't control your destiny. You know, a lot of people during 2020, if we're honest, were down, and people got unfocused on the promises of God. And during that midst of hardship, he experienced a dream, a 20-year dream, that came to pass in his life for an international plane, because we have offices all over the world. And during 2020, during the pandemic, just like God would do, that plane manifested debt-free to the ministry. But just before that, God had told him, get that dream out of the closet. And so there's a lot of Christians today, you have your dream in the closet that God put in your heart, maybe as a young person. And God wants you to know that you can get that dream out of the closet. And he teaches in here how to recapture your dreams. It's not too late. The vision will not be prolonged and it will be fulfilled. Can you say amen? Amen. One more thing. This is the 50th anniversary. There's 50 of his classic messages on here. 50 messages on a jump drive. So you can throw that in your car. One of them is called The Fourth Man, where he heard the call of God that Oral Roberts preached, called to battle, destined to win, The Law of Progression, where he's talking about the canoe story. So check that out. And then lastly, 2024, the year of progressing, advancing, experiencing promotion, and seeing your highest expectations fulfilled. Church, this is our time in the earth. Just like Moses told the children of Israel to go forward in the midst of everything that seems impossible, God is with us. He is greater in us than anything we'll face in the world. And it's our time to progress and advance the body of Christ. Can you say amen?
Amen.
Pastor, God bless you guys. Good to be with you.
Take advantage of those resources, I'll tell you. That is a blessing. You know, it's just an honor when you're able to be around someone that walks in these kind of shoes for this length of time and has known the world around for not just his teaching, but his character.
Yes.
And really, there's nothing more important than a man's character. And, you know, you can say man's a real character, or you can say that man's got a lot of character. And there's nothing wrong with either one of them. Obviously, the best one is to have a good character, huh? But he is a character also. He's a fun-loving guy, and he's been a blessing for our nation and for the body of Christ, and especially the household of faith, because he's continued to do the only thing he knew to do, and that was to walk by faith.
Hallelujah.
And not by sight. Amen? So give Dr. Jerry Savelle a great big Hobbs, New Mexico welcome, please.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Sit on. All right, can you hear me now? Doesn't sound like it's on.
Yeah, it's on.
It's on.
Yeah.
It's on now. You just needed the touch. You got the touch. All right, you can be seated. Praise the Lord. My goodness, what a great service already. You guys were awesome in the praise and worship. And she talked so fast during the announcements, I leaned over to Tony and I said, I think that girl could quote the whole Bible in about 30 seconds. You did a wonderful job. Amen. You met Eric, another gentleman that travels with me all over the world. He's a former professional football player, came to my Bible school about 25 years ago, been a great blessing to my life. My wife asked me many times when I'm traveling overseas, who's going with you? I said, Tony. She said, okay, I know you'll be safe. So Tony Armstrong, stand up and give him a good warm welcome. Amen. Well, it's good to be back in Hobbs. Man, it's been a while. But good to be back. And I heard Jesse was here, what, night before last? And isn't he a blessing? Did you have fun with Jesse? He's my little brother. Now, he brags all over the world about being taller than me. But all it is his hair. That's all, just his hair. But I'm older, so he's my little brother. Let me tell you a funny story about Jesse and I. You got time?
Yes.
I was telling Pastor at lunch. I grew up in North Louisiana. Jesse in South Louisiana, New Orleans. And if you know anything about Louisiana, North Louisiana and South Louisiana, it's like two different countries. And but I was always drawn to the Cajun culture. I loved the Cajun food. I loved the Cajun culture. And so I went to college in South Louisiana, and I wasn't serving the Lord back in those days. And I learned a game, a card game that is very popular in South Louisiana called Bure. It's a very mental game. You can win everything everybody else in the is playing owns, and you can lose everything you have in one hand. And I got really good at Bure. In fact, I played it all the time. And, of course, I wasn't serving the Lord. And we would go to the Fountain Blue Lounge every weekend and drink and gamble. And they had a bandstand. They had a dance floor. And the gambling part, you could look out from the room into the dance floor and the band. And I could hear the band every night or every weekend. But I never went out there because I was playing cards. So later, much later, when Jesse and I met, I asked him, I said, when I found out he was had a rock and roll band when he was in high school and so forth, and he was a senior in high school when I was in my second year of college. I said, Jesse, did you ever play the Fountain Blue Lounge? He said, every weekend. I said, are you serious? He said, I was there every weekend, me and my band. Jesse and I were in the same building every weekend. Now, we didn't know each other then, never met each other at that time. But I say, don't you know God was looking down and thought, if those two boys only knew what I had in store for them.
Hallelujah.
Amen. So I think it's interesting that how God brought us together, you know, and we're almost inseparable now. We're like brothers. And what a great man of God he is. What a great friend he is. So I like to know that Jesse has been in ahead of me, because then I can come out and straighten up the mess. Okay. Praise God. Hallelujah. Got your Bibles with you tonight? Let's open them, first of all, to 2 Timothy chapter 3. 2 Timothy chapter 3. Did Jesse pick on me last night at all? Was he kind?
He was very kind.
Okay, that's the last thing I'll say about him. Okay. Many places I go, they tell me, you ought to have been here the other night. Jesse picked on you. And I said, yeah, he's good at that. But anyway, that's all I'm going to say about Jesse, okay? 2 Timothy chapter 3, and look at verse 1. This know also, that in the last days perilous times shall come. How many of you believe we're in the last days?
Yes.
We may not be in the final stages of the last days, but the last days actually began on the day of Pentecost.
Right.
Peter stood up and quoted Joel and said, this is that which the prophet Joel said in the last days. So the last days is a period of time on God's timetable, but they actually began on the day of Pentecost. That's, you know, a long time ago, so surely we're not in the beginning of the last days. I don't think we're in the middle of the last days. We're in the last of the last days. Amen. And notice he said, in the last days, perilous times shall come. The Amplified Bible defines perilous times as times of great stress and trouble, hard to deal with and hard to bear. But I want you to notice the word impossible is not in there. Hard to deal with and hard to bear. And a lot of people have found out that that's true. We are experiencing times, and particularly since COVID, you know, times of great stress and trouble. And a lot of people are finding them hard to bear, hard to deal with. But I like to remind people, it didn't say impossible to deal with. All things are possible to him that believeth. All things are possible to our God. Amen. Amen. So this is a wonderful time for the body of Christ to shine.
That's right.
Amen. To rise and shine.
Yeah.
Amen. Amen. Because it's a time in which, I've said many times, when the world is in the condition that it's in right now, people finally figure out what they've been doing is not working anymore. What they relied on is not reliable anymore. What they thought was stable is not stable anymore. And they begin to look for answers, and then they run to Christ. So this is a great time. In fact, there's a great move of God taking place all over the world. Now, I came to this in 1969, and that was in the early stages of the charismatic movement. And I was privileged in 1970 to go to Pismo Beach. Anybody seen the movie The Jesus Revolution?
Yes.
Anybody seen that? Is talking about those days of they called it the Jesus movement, the Jesus Revolution. I was not in the movie, but I was there when all that happened. Okay. And I spent about 2 weeks on Pismo Beach with 140,000 hippies and drug addicts. Now, I'd never done drugs in my life. I didn't know one drug from another. And when I went out there, I looked over that crowd and I thought, what in the world could I possibly say to these people? I don't know anything about drugs. I owned an automotive business. And I was just your all-American boy, you know, just straight and crew cut, and a lot of the young men that I graduated from high school with, they got into the drug culture. In fact, I owned an automotive business, paint and body work. I restored classic cars. My dad and I built hot rods and race cars. I grew up on racetracks. And a lot of my friends that I went to high school with, they got into that drug culture, the hippie movement. They brought their vans to my shop for me to paint all these psychedelic colors. I like to went blind painting their vans, you know. Wild stuff, you know, flowers all over them and everything. And they were going to hate Ashbury and be hippies and drug addicts and all that. I thought that's the dumbest thing I ever heard of. So, isn't it amazing? When I finally surrendered my life to the Lord in February 1969, my ministry began in the streets of Shreveport, Louisiana, ministering to drug addicts, alcoholics, prostitutes, and that's how it started.
Yeah.
And when I got out to Bismo Beach, I thought, Lord, how am I ever going to communicate with these people? I don't know anything about acid. I don't know anything about speed. Now, horsepower I knew.
Yeah.
That kind of speed. But that other speed, you'd have to ask Jesse. I don't know anything about that. I went to picking on Jesse again. Jesse took trips all over the world, never left his living room. You know? On speed, you know. But I didn't know anything about that. But boy, I drove fast. When my dad passed away, somebody asked me, what did your dad leave behind to you? I said, the ability to drive fast. Amen. And so when I got out to Pismo, I mean, I felt like someone that was out of sync with everything that was going on there. And I'm standing on this sand dune looking at all these drug addicts and hippies, and it was wild. We thought we had hippies in Louisiana. They were wannabes after I saw what I saw in California. That was the wildest thing I'd ever seen in my life. And I'm saying, Lord, how am I going to communicate with these people? He said, son, it's not your knowledge of drugs that will win them. It's your knowledge of me. Tell them about me. Take Jesus to them. So that's what I did. And we won thousands of them to the Lord, baptized thousands of them in the Pacific Ocean. And so I was part of that Jesus movement, Jesus revolution. And then what I learned there, I brought it back to Shreveport, Louisiana, and began to minister to people like that. And that's how I started this ministry. And then Brother Copeland came for a second visit. And while he was there, actually on the way there, he wrecked his automobile and wiped out the whole left side of a brand new 1969 Pontiac Bonneville. Asked the pastor if he knew anybody that could repair his car. He was there for the week. So my wife grew up in that church that Brother Copeland was speaking in. And I started going there and had only been going there for about 3 months. So the pastor told him about me. And so I repaired Brother Copeland's car while he was there in town. So I didn't get to go to his day services, but I went each night. And one day he came over to watch me work on his car. And I'm grinding this quarter panel down, and he's standing about this far from me with his hands folded like this and just, you know, with them piercing eyes and just looking at me. And I thought, dear God, I've got 9,000 questions about the life of faith. And I've never known anybody that knows more about it than this man. And he's standing here next to me. So I put the grinder down and I said, Brother Cope, do you mind if I ask you a few questions about the life of faith? He said, not at all. So he shared with me and was very kind. And then he said, I've got to go and get ready for the service. Will you be there tonight? I said, yes, sir, I will. Got to the service and he preached about 15 minutes and just stopped and said, Jerry, stand up. I was really shocked to even remember my name. And I was saying about where you are. And he said, Jerry, stand up. And of course, I'm about 3 months old in the Lord. So I'm not familiar with all of this. Now, my wife, she grew up in Pentecostal church. She's been baptized in the Holy Ghost since she's 8 years old. So back in those early days, as far as I was concerned, Carolyn and the Holy Ghost were one and the same. You know, She was teaching me everything, you know. So he said, Jerry, stand up. I stood up. And he said, when I left you today, I was in prayer, and God showed me that you and I will be a team, and we will spend the rest of our lives together preaching the Word of God all over the world, and it'd be your responsibility to believe God for the perfect timing for the team to begin, set out. And then he went on with his sermon. I turned to Carolyn and the Holy Ghost. I said, Carolyn, what did all that mean? She said, well, I think we're moving to Fort Worth, Texas. I said, why? She said, well, he said you're going to be a team, spend the rest of your lives preaching together all over the world. I said, wow, that would be an amazing opportunity. And so it was several months later after I was able to shut my business down and then able to move to Fort Worth, go to work with Brother Copeland. And back in those days, it was just Kenneth Copeland, Gloria Copeland, his father, A.W. Copeland, we all called him Granddad, and one secretary, a bookkeeper, and me. And it was Brother Copeland and Gloria and Jerry Savelle traveled all over the country together. They went nowhere without me. And so that was those first couple of years, that was my Bible school. Every time we'd go into a meeting, my job was to set the building up, get it ready for him, set up the sound system, and then get him to the hotel, get him from the hotel to the meeting place, and then usually he'd have me open the service up in prayer, and I might share a few things, and then I'd have to, one of my jobs was to find somebody that could play the piano where he might sing a couple of songs before he preached, and then once I got through with my part, then I would sit on the platform and wait for my cue. Now, he might sing first or share something. And I'm sitting on the platform with a headset on because I'm recording all the messages on reel-to-reel tapes. Anybody remember reel-to-reel? And so I'm waiting for my cue. And it was always this, when he was ready for me to turn the machine on. Turn me on, Jerry. So I'd turn the recorder on, make sure I'm getting a good recording. Then I'd put the headset down. And now what he's teaching, that was my Bible school. I'm learning faith. Okay. Now we did, back in those early days, we didn't go anywhere for one night, 3 weeks at a time, three services a day. So I heard three times a day for 3 weeks, turn me on, Jerry. Turn me on, Jerry. Turn me on, Jerry. And I just like to announce, if it hadn't been for Jerry Savelle, Kenneth Copeland would have never got turned on. Amen. So anyway, I was praying one day, and Brother Copeland, about after the first year I worked with him, he had me start doing the morning services. And we were out in Long Beach, California. We just before we went there, I was invited to come to Hot Springs, Arkansas to do Russellville, Arkansas, to the Arkansas campus to do a Jesus rally. And then I told Brother Copeland, I will meet you in Long Beach. So I did that meeting there at the campus, and then I flew out to Long Beach. And while I was on my way out there, the Lord said, it's time for you to launch out into your own ministry. I said, well, Lord, you said we'd be a team, spend the rest of our lives preaching together. If I leave, it'll split up the team. He said, no, it'll enable the team to cover twice as much territory with the same message.
Yeah, praise God.
And I said, well, Lord, I'm not leaving until you reveal it to Brother Copeland. Because I wasn't looking for going out and ministering. I was happy doing what I was doing. I was prepared to do that for the rest of my life. And I said, so you'll have to reveal that to Brother Copeland, and I'm not leaving till you tell him. So we're flying back from Long Beach. And he had, back in those days, a little Cessna 421, and we're setting up in the plane. I'm in the cockpit with him in the right seat. And as soon as he got his cruising altitude, he turned on the autopilot. And then he turned to me and he said, when are you leaving? I said, what do you mean? He said, the Lord said to me this week that you're about to launch out into your own ministry. Wow. I said, well, I told the Lord I was not going to do that until he revealed it to you. And he said, well, he did. I don't want it to happen, but I know it's God, and I'm not going to stand in the way. I said, well, Brother Copeland, as far as I'm concerned, we will always be a team. We'll just be two separate organizations, but we'll always be a team. So that's what has taken place. I'm in my 55th year of ministry, and I've been preaching with Kenneth Copeland all over the world for 54 of those 55 years. We're still a team.
Hallelujah.
And that is unheard of today. You know, the Lord said to me not too long ago, he said, from here on out, your longevity and your relationship with Brother Copeland will speak as loud as any sermon you preach. Because you don't find that today in ministry. That people work together without being competitive, without jealousy. We've never had a cross word, you know. And you just don't see that in ministry today. So it's a tremendous testimony to the body of Christ. Amen. I learned a lot of things from Brother Copeland in those early days. And of course, he introduced me to the ministry of Kenneth Hagin. He was always talking about Brother Hagin. And so while I was working for Brother Copeland as an associate minister, we would go hear Brother Hagin. And Brother Copeland would say to me, tonight I want to introduce you to Brother Hagin. I said, okay. So after the service, Brother Hagin and Brother Copeland would be standing there talking. I'd be standing right next to Brother Copeland holding his Bible. And, you know, I'm not a pushy person. I didn't try to make it happen myself. I said, if it's God, God will make it happen. So I just standing there being obedient, listening to their conversation. They'd get through talking. We'd walk off. We'd get in the car and Brother Copeland say, I forgot to introduce you to Brother Hagin. I said, that's fine. Time will come. That happened 3 or 4 different times. I stood there just being a good little trooper. He forgot to introduce me. Well, then one time, after I've already in my own ministry, Brother Copeland asked me and Brother Hagin to do a meeting with him out in Southern California. And so this was my first time to meet Brother Hagin. And Brother Copeland had me to do the first service. Brother Hagin was to follow me. And that service, the anointing God hit that place. People started getting out of wheelchairs. I mean, miracles started happening. And I realized I was getting into Brother Hagin's time, so I just shut it off. I said, I'm sorry, folks. It's time for Brother Hagin. Brother Hagin, come on up. And Brother Hagin walked up there, and he said, well, if there's one thing I've learned in all these years of ministry, when to preach, when not to, the anointing's on you, boy, go for it. And he went and sat down, you know, and just left me with the service. Well, then from that meeting, the next, before we left Southern California, Brother Hagin said, you're one of the rising stars in the charismatic movement. And the Lord told me to give you a shot of penicillin, a spiritual shot of penicillin. I want you to speak in my camp meeting this year. So that began the relationship with Brother Hagin. And of course, you know, I learned so much about faith from Brother Hagin. And then one day, and of course, I had been mentored by Oral Roberts through his resources, even though I'd never met the man. But I had great respect for him. And one day, we're preaching in Charlotte, North Carolina. And Brother Copeland, I preached every day. I usually preach on Thursday nights as well. And so Brother Copeland normally closes out the service for the week. But that night, when he got up to preach, he said, let's open our Bibles, like he always did. Let's open our Bibles tonight. And we're all sitting there waiting, and he didn't tell us where. And he's holding a podium like this and just looking at his Bible. Just looking around a little bit. He said, let's open our Bibles tonight. He didn't tell us where. You know, inquiring minds want to know. So finally, he just closed in and said, Jerry, God told me you're to close out the service tonight. Come on up here and finish this. Well, I didn't have a clue what I was going to preach. I mean, it's not that I didn't have something. I just wasn't prepared for that night because he always did the last service. So he said, come on up here and close the meeting out. So I walked up there, and he had someone bring a chair and set it about this close to the podium. And when I walked by him, he grabbed the coattail of my coat, and he said, tell us everything God said. Don't leave out anything. You understand me, boy? I said, yes, sir. I thought, I wish I knew what God had said, you know. I didn't have a clue where I was going. So I just laid my Bible down And when I looked at it, it opened. It fell open to the book of Daniel. And I heard come out of me the sermon that I heard Oral Roberts preach when I was a young boy, when I heard the call to the ministry, and his most famous 10th sermon called The Fourth Man. And I heard that sermon coming out of me. I preached The Fourth Man just like Oral Roberts did. I mean, hallelujah. Fire is flying and so was spit. I mean, dear Lord. And when it was over with, Brother Copeland jumped up and said to his television organizer, person that handled his television ministry, "I don't know what you got planned for my program, but cancel it and get this message Jerry just preached on as quick as you can." So it came out in about 3 weeks. Little did I know, Oral and Evelyn Roberts are sitting in their home watching that program that morning and saw me preaching Brother Roberts' sermon on the fourth man. And so Monday morning, I get a call from Tulsa, Oklahoma. My secretary said, "There's a lady on the phone. She says she's Oral Roberts' personal secretary. Her name is Ruth Rooks, and she needs to talk to you." I thought, they're going to sue me. But I told them that this is a sermon I heard Oral Roberts preach, you know. And she said, "Oral and Evelyn were watching you on Kenneth Copeland's broadcast yesterday, and he told me to call you. He wants you in his office this morning at 11 o'clock. Can I tell him you'll be here?" I thought, well, who tells Oral Roberts no? Right. So I jumped in my plane and I flew to Tulsa. I'd been on the campus before, but I had no idea where his office was. So I asked a couple of students. I said, "Can you take me to Dr. Roberts' office?" They said, "Oh, no, we're not allowed to go there." I said, "Well, I've been invited to come. Is anybody here that can tell me how to get to his office?" So one brave student took me to the building and said, "You're on your own now. Get in the elevator." You know, said, "That's the Vatican. We're not allowed to go there, you know." So I went up to his office and met Ruth Rooks, and she got on the intercom and said, "Jerry Savelle is in my office." So he walks out, and I'd never met him before. I'd watched his TV programs and all, and listened to him on reel-to-reel tape, you know, from his old tent crusades. And when I turned around, she said, "He'll be coming out of that door right behind you." So I turned around to wait for him. When he came out, he did his arms like this. He said, "Come here, my brother. I've been wanting to meet you for a long time." I turned around to see who else came in the building. Nobody but me and Ruth. I said, "You talking to me?" He said, "Yes, I'm talking to you. Come here." So I didn't know how close I was supposed to get to him. I just took a couple of steps. "Come here." I took a few more steps. He said, "Come here." And I walked as close as I thought I was allowed to. And he just took me in his arms and pulled me up to his chest, began to prophesy over me. And he said, "Come into my office." I thought, okay, the attorneys are in there waiting to sue me for preaching Oral Roberts' message, you know. We went in his office and there's nobody there. He said, "Sit down on the sofa here." And I sat down. He sat down next to me. He said, "I told Evelyn yesterday when I saw you preaching my message, it's time for us to develop a relationship with this young man. I heard that he heard the call of God watching me when he was 10 years old in his grandmother's home in Oklahoma City. And he said, and you preached my message yesterday." And he said, "I just want you to know, I've never heard anybody preach it better than you did, except, of course, myself." You know? And that began a lifelong relationship. Amen. We preached together. We traveled together. I served on his board for over 20 years. And so Kenneth Copeland, Kenneth Hagin, Oral Roberts, and then everything I know about world evangelism, I learned from T.L. and Daisy Osborne. Yeah. Those were my four mentors. Yeah. And every one of those men taught me faith. Yeah. Every one of them. Yeah. Great men of faith. Yes. And lived the life of faith. Yeah. And I had wonderful examples. The Bible says, follow those who through faith and patience inherit the promises. So God arranged for me to have four of the greatest men of God of our generation, men of faith, as my mentors. And became close friends with them and preached with them. And I was in their home. They were in my home many times. And what a great privilege it was. So I learned faith from these four men. And I've been living that way now for 55 years. And people will say from time to time, is there any possibility you might teach something other than faith? Well, I always answer the way Kenneth Hagin answered. When you learn this, we'll move on to something new. Yeah. Amen. And he preached faith all of his life. And I'm so glad he did. Praise God. Amen. In fact, in my briefcase over there, I have a little iPod. And I have all those early sermons of Kenneth Hagin's that I heard. They were on reel to reel. I had them downloaded on the iPod. I take them everywhere. I listen to Kenneth Hagin every day. I listen to Oral Roberts and Brother Copeland and those early messages. And T.L. And they continue to inspire me to this day. So notice here, he says, in the last days, perilous times will come. Times of great stress and trouble, hard to deal with and hard to bear. But I learned back then in those early days that nothing is impossible to those who believe. Are there any believers in the house? Then nothing is impossible unto you and me. No matter what kind of times we're in. You remember, the disciples asked Jesus one time, and it's recorded in Matthew chapter 24. What are the signs of the end? And one of the first things he said was, see that no man deceive you. So apparently there's going to be a lot of deception. Okay? And that's true right now. There's a lot of deception taking place in the world, and a lot of it's coming from so-called preachers. Amen. I mean, we wouldn't pay any attention to it if it was worldly people doing it. Because they don't know anything anyway. But when somebody mounts the pulpit in a nice suit and throws up his hand, thus saith the Lord, and starts preaching unbelief, people fall for it. Okay? In fact, Paul talks about this. And so, notice that he said, there will be times of great stress and trouble. Jesus, in that discourse that he gave in Matthew chapter 24, he said, see that no man deceive you, and then also see that you be not troubled. I wrote years ago, I mean, this is probably 45 years ago, I wrote in my Bible that I had at the time, it was a wide margin Bible, and you had plenty of room to write notes, and I wrote right in that where it says, see that you be not troubled, I wrote, Jesus says, it's possible to live in a troubled world and not be troubled. Amen. It's possible to live in a troubled world and not be troubled. So I said right then, well, I walked in there where my wife was. I said, Carolyn, it is possible to live in a troubled world and not be troubled. And that's exactly the way you and I are going to live. We are not going to be troubled by anything that is going on in the world around us. Amen. Hi, my brother. And so that's something that I've endeavored to master, you might say, is to not be troubled by any trouble. Amen. Now, you can ask my wife, I'm not a person that's easily moved. I got the word in my heart to such a level that, and I learned from Paul in Acts chapter 20, when he talked about, you know, every city he would go to, the Holy Spirit had told him in advance, trouble is waiting for you. And he made this statement in verse 24. None of these things move me. And I told Carol, I said, that's the way I'm going to be. None of these things are going to move me. And you can ask my wife, all these years, I mean, we've experienced trouble. We've experienced challenges. I'm just like everybody else. I have an opportunity to quit. I have an opportunity to compromise. But we pass those opportunities by. Amen. And I don't get down about anything. Now, I get down, but not down. Amen. But I'm not an easily discouraged person. Why? Because I know the word. And Jesus said, see that you be not troubled. He said, my peace I leave with you. Not as the world gives, but my peace I leave with you. You know, when's the body of Christ going to start believing the Bible?
Come on. Hallelujah.
We sing songs about, you know, he's the way maker, and then walk out the door and worry about how we're going to get through something. We just sing all the time and don't believe anything we sing. Amen.
Good.
And you know, I learned a long time ago, don't be moved by the crowd.
So good. Yeah.
Sometimes you ought to stand up here and try to preach to people that look like you. No, not in this church, but other churches.
Yeah.
You know, you all look like you are hanging on to every word. But there's a lot of places, dear God. I remember I went to Toronto. Anybody remember the Toronto blessing?
Yes.
Okay. I was there before it broke out. Okay. And I went for one night. Never been to this church before and didn't know the pastor. And on the way up there, the Lord asked me, would you be willing to stay in Toronto for as long as I ask you to stay? I said, well, Lord, I'll do anything you ask me to do. But you do know I'm scheduled to be somewhere else tomorrow night. And then I'm scheduled to be somewhere else the night after that. He said, would you be willing to stay in Toronto for as long as I ask you to stay? I said, well, Lord, I'll do anything you want me to do. But pastors don't like you canceling meetings one day in advance. He said, would you be willing to stay in, you know, you're not going to win an argument with God. Would you be willing to stay in Toronto as long as I ask you to stay? I said, yes, sir, I will. I said, would you mind handling those pastors where I'm supposed to be? So I got to my room and I had a short time to get prepared to go to the meeting that night. And when I got to my room, I was putting on my suit and my phone rang. And it was the pastor where I was supposed to be the next night. He said, Brother Jerry, I was praying today and the Lord told me that he wanted you to stay in Toronto. So I release you from your meeting tomorrow night and you can come at another time. I said, thank you, sir. I appreciate that. As soon as I hung up, the next pastor called and said the same thing. And so I was released. And when I got to the church that night and they took me into the pastor's office, he said, Brother Jerry, and this is the first I ever met the man. He said, the Lord asked me to ask you, would you be willing to stay here for as long as this? I said, well, I've already answered that question. And I said, yes, sir, I'll stay here as long as the Lord tells me to stay. So I wind up staying 21 nights. And no two services were alike. It was absolutely amazing. And then the Lord said, go home and rest for a while. And then he sent me back. And I stayed another 14 nights. No two services were alike. And then he said, go home and rest. I went back and stayed another 9 days. And no two services were alike. And then I came home and that was the end of that meeting there. And then the following week, the Toronto Blessing Movement broke out. Okay. So there was a number of pastors who had heard about my meetings up there. And they traveled to Toronto to be in them. And one pastor, he said, Brother Jerry, would you come and do this at our church? We need a move of God in our church like this. I said, well, Pastor, I can't promise you that it'll happen. You know, I'd be happy to come, but I can't promise you that it'll happen there like it happened here. I said, but I can tell you this. The reason it happened here, number one, Pastor and I made an agreement that everything was subject to change.
Yes.
If we don't get to sing, we don't sing.
Yeah.
If we don't receive an offering, we don't receive an offering. If I don't preach, I don't preach.
Yeah.
We're just going to flow with God.
Yeah.
And I said, there were days, and I was fasting that whole time. And there were times when I'd see the whole service in advance before I ever got there.
Yeah.
And I'd just go and reenact what I saw in the Spirit.
Yeah.
And there was one night I had met this pastor. He was an Italian-speaking pastor in Toronto, and the pastor where I was preaching introduced me, and that's the first time I ever met the man. And I got there that night, and the Lord told me before I arrived, he said, you're not preaching tonight. I said, okay, who is? He said, I'll tell you when you get there. So I got there, and that pastor was sitting about where you are, sir. That's a good seat, by the way. You're getting all of it tonight. And I said, called his name. I said, you're preaching tonight. His eyes got about that big. I said, come on up. And he walked up there. Now, I mean, I just met him at lunch that day. He walked up there and he said, kind of like the way I was, Brother Copeland had me do that last service. He said, I didn't come prepared to preach. I said, well, the anointing is going to be on you, and you're going to preach like you had never preached before. He started preaching. He stopped three times and said, I'm sorry, folks. I didn't know I knew this. I have to write this down. And boy, I'm telling you, we had some meetings. So this pastor asked me, he said, would you come and do this in our church? I said, well, number one, I'm not sure you're prepared to do what that pastor did in Toronto. Yeah. Number one, yeah. Everything was subject to change. Yeah. Yeah. Are you willing to do that? Well, I don't know, you know. I mean, you know, we got to sing. No, you don't have to sing.
Come on.
It's good to sing.
Right.
It's wonderful. It helps create an atmosphere.
Yeah, right.
But it's not mandatory.
Come on.
Well, I don't know how our people would act if we don't sing. Well, then you're not ready for this.
Right. That's right.
Wow. Well, okay. We won't sing if that's. Well, I'm not saying we won't sing. I'm just saying it's a possibility.
Yeah.
What you normally are programmed to do, you won't get to do any of it. Oh, I don't know, Brother Jerry. I said, well, when you know, call me. Well, he called. So he cut. I said, yeah, I'll come. So the first night, oh, my Lord, if there was any place on the planet that needed a move of God, it was this church. That's the deadest place I've ever been in my life. I might as well have been preaching to the wall. And the only life in that church was the pastor. And he's sitting on the platform behind me. And I mean, he's having his own personal move of God. But the rest of them just sat there and just looked at me. I was so ready to get out of that church. And so pastor said, now, Brother Jerry's going to go to my office and pray about another night. See if we're going to do another night. He said, go to my office, Brother Jerry, and I'll come and ask you if we're going to go another night. And I'll come back out and tell you folks. Well, I'm walking down the hall, and I'm working on my speech. I thought, there ain't no way I'm going another night in this church. I am not a glutton for punishment. He does need a revival, but I'm not the man to bring it. And I don't want to hurt the man. But I was prepared to say, Pastor, you do need a move of God. There's no doubt about it. But apparently I'm not the man to bring it. Give me a hand and I'll agree with you that God will send you somebody. You know? So I was all prepared to say that. And he comes running down the hall. I hear him running down the hall. And he opens the door just enough to get his head in. He said, Brother Jerry, do we go another night? I said, yes, sir. We're having a move of God. He took off running. I said, you fool. You're not... You were out of here and you just blew it. And then the Lord taught me something. He said, now tomorrow night, I'm going to teach you on the law of combustion. I said, the law of combustion? He said, the spiritual law of combustion. He said, tomorrow night when you come into that service, the only spark in that church is that pastor. When he turns the service over to you, turn your back on the audience. Don't preach to them. Preach to the pastor, and the sparks will begin to fly. That's the law of combustion. And so I turned my back on the audience, never looked at them the whole night, and preached to that pastor, and he had a Holy Ghost runaway, praise God, and it spread all over the church, and we stayed 14 nights there, praise God. Amen. Hallelujah. Oh, it was wonderful, praise God. So I got to visit with Brother Hagin because back in Brother Hagin's early days, after he started his field ministry, he'd stay in places for weeks and weeks on end. So I asked him, I said, Brother Hagin, how do you do that? I said, you know, I get invitations all the time, but I don't know how to tell people when I'll come if we're moving into more extended meetings. He said, well, pastor would ask me to come, and he said, and I'd take all the invitations, I'd pray over them. And the Lord would say, that's number one. He said, call this pastor. He's number one. And he said, and this pastor's number two. He said, and this church is number three. He said, I'd call the pastor that was number one on the list. said, Pastor, I'll be there, and I'll stay until God tells me to leave. And he said, and I called Pastor number two, and he said, now I'll be at your church when I'm finished with Pastor number one. Wow. He said, well, when that be? I don't know, but you're number two. Then he called Pastor number three and said, and I'll be at your church when I'm done with number one and number two. Well, when will that be? I don't know. When I finish number two, I'll be at your church. I said, he said, that's the only way I could do it, because you don't know how long you're going to be there. Yeah. And that was quite an interesting time, praise God. Yeah. Well, I see it coming back. Yeah. It's already started. Yeah. It's already happening all over the world, praise God. Amen. It is happening all over the world. We were in Ethiopia here just not too long ago. I'm telling you, we had a move of God there. One service, the crowd broke away from the ushers and come running to the front just to touch me. And they were about to rip my clothes off of me. They were pulling my arms out of socket. They slid under crowds and grabbed my legs. And I finally said, Tony, get me out of here. They're hurting me. He just picked me up and took me out, you know. I mean, there's hunger. Contrary to CNN, there is a hunger for God in the world today. Amen. There's a move of God taking place. And what I saw in those early days in California, it started all over again. They're having the same kind of move as they had in the late 60s and early 70s, praise God. So, you know, we're in a good position to experience some of the greatest times we've ever had in the Lord. I think we ought to give him a shout in advance. Amen. Hallelujah. Now, notice in verse 14, the Apostle Paul makes this statement. Now, here's how you deal with times of great stress and trouble. Perilous times. Here's how you deal with them. Verse 14. Continue thou in the things which thou hast learned and been assured of. You know what that says to me? We don't need some new revelation nobody's ever heard of to get us over in these times.
That's right.
I do a podcast I call Back to the Basics.
Yeah.
And I tell people, there's so many new people coming into this today that they've never heard the basics.
Right.
And I was privileged to sit under these great men that I mentioned earlier. And three out of four of them have already gone to heaven. Yeah. And I'm in churches today, they never even heard of Oral Roberts.
Yeah.
Never even heard of Kenneth Hagin. And I'm very close friends of Richard Roberts. Richard and I have been, well, as long as I've known the Roberts family, Richard and I have been very close. And I told Richard, I said, I refuse to allow your father's legacy to die.
Come on.
I talk about those men in every sermon I preach.
Yeah.
But it's amazing that a lot of places I go today, they've never heard of them.
Yeah.
They've never heard those basic principles.
Yeah.
And notice here, Paul says, in these times of great stress and trouble, hard to deal with and hard to bear, the way to overcome them is continue in the things which you've learned.
Yes. Hallelujah.
Now, the body of Christ is notorious for learning something and letting it go and follow what tickles their ears.
Yeah.
Amen.
Yeah.
The body of Christ, and particularly charismatic people, are the most fickle people on the planet. Let me try this side of the auditorium. Got no response over there. Charismatic people are the most fickle people in the world. I like to say, you never know what's lurking in the mind of a charismatic. You know? They come and they go. And particularly in the time in which we live today. I mean, I preached in some churches. I've preached in every year for over 50 years. And some of those pastors are not the same men they were just a few years ago. I don't hear them talking like they used to talk. I don't hear them preaching like they used to preach. I heard one man say, well, Brother Jerry, you know that faith movement is over. Well, that tells me how little he knows about faith, because it's never been a movement. It's a lifestyle. The just shall live by faith. Amen. It's not a movement. Never has been, never will be. You know, people say that faith movement. I don't like that, because it's not a movement. It's a lifestyle. It's the way God has commanded us to live, not suggested, commanded us to live. Amen. And when you say that faith movement is over, nobody wants to hear that anymore. Well, you just told me that those that don't want to hear it anymore don't have any way to overcome what's happening in the world.
That's right.
Because this is the victory to overcome the world, even our faith.
Yeah.
Amen. Without faith, it's not likely you're going to win your battles. Amen. Faith has got me where I am, and faith is going to take me where I'm going. Praise God. Not only that, my mama didn't raise a fool. I started out in faith. I don't know it. I don't know any religious tradition. This is all I know. I started in faith. This is all I know. And it's been working for me for 55 years. So I'm just going to stick with it. Praise God. Amen. And if people don't want to hear it, don't invite me.
Amen.
There was one pastor that he went through a lot of trouble in his early days, went through a divorce, went through all kind of trouble. And Buddy Harrison mentored him and got him back on his feet and asked me to go and preach in his church, a little small church. And I became acquainted with him, and I'd go quite often and preach faith. And he got a hold of the word of faith, and he eventually built a church that had about 3,000 people in it. And he'd have me come every year and do a faith convention for him. And then he started inviting some other ministers that were notorious for standing in their pulpits and saying the faith movement is over. And when I got there this one particular time and I saw who else he had on the schedule to speak, I said, Pastor, do you know anything about these guys? Oh, yeah, they really got a message. I said, but have you heard them preach? Have you heard them preach in their own church? I said, this one guy, I have messages, recorded messages of him standing up and saying, don't listen to Kenneth Hagin, Fred Price, Charles Capps, Jerry Savelle. And this is the man you want in your church, and you want him to speak with me in this convention? I said, I'll preach faith and he'll come right behind me and tear it all down, or try to.
Right.
I said, so if this is what you want in your conventions from now on, don't invite me because I will ruin your party.
Right.
You know what I stand for.
Right. Hallelujah.
So I didn't go back. And he kept having this guy come and some other guys very similar to what he preached. And the church started going down. And then he calls me several years later. Brother Jerry, would you come back? I said, well, I'm not sure. He said, I wish I'd have listened to you. He said, I'm trying to build my church back. I said, well, you built it on faith to start with. Why did you ever leave it? He said, well, I was encouraged or deceived, really, about what these men preached, and it all sounded good, but I learned it wasn't quite the truth. And it almost destroyed my church. Amen.
Yeah.
So don't ever walk away from faith. Don't ever walk away from faith.
Right.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Hold fast, the Bible says, to your faith.
Yes.
Hold fast to sound doctrine, praise God.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
That is if you want to overcome perilous times.
Right.
If you're happy just existing and you're happy just surviving, then I guess you can follow all that strange teaching. But if you're interested in overcoming and winning, then stay in faith. Can you say amen? Now, continue in the things which you have learned. Let's go to the book of Hebrews for a moment. Hebrews chapter 2. Excuse me. And notice in verse 1, therefore, we ought to give the more earnest heed to the things which we have heard, lest at any time we should let them slip. Notice, give the more earnest heed to the things we've heard. It sounds like to me God is endeavoring to make a very important point. That we don't need some new revelation nobody's ever heard of before.
That's right.
So good.
Amen.
Amen.
That we just continue in the basic principles. Now, I'm still preaching those same basic principles today like I preached them 54 years ago, but I know more about them today. I have more insight. I have more revelation. And I have more testimonies from them. But you can go back. In fact, Brother Copeland did this here just a few years ago, before I preached in the Believers Convention in Fort Worth on Thursday night. He said, I want to show you something that Jerry was preaching in 1981 and what he's been preaching here all this week. And they showed the video of me preaching in that same convention, but in Charlotte, North Carolina in 1981. I was preaching the same thing. I mean, almost word for word, but I just had more insight, more revelation, and more testimonies of it working.
Glory to God.
Amen. So what am I doing? I'm giving the more earnest heed to the things which I learned. Amen. The Amplified Bible says we ought to pay much closer attention than ever to the truths that we have heard. Why? Because this is not the same world we lived in 5 years ago.
That's right.
And it's getting worse and worse.
That's right.
Amen?
Yeah.
Well, if you haven't learned anything about how to live the life of faith, you got a serious problem.
Yeah.
It's not too late to learn.
That's right.
I mean, we're also living in days of acceleration.
Amen.
What took others of us 25 years to learn, you can learn in 25 weeks, praise God. God's accelerating things. But if I were you, I'd get real busy and fast. Amen? Because this world's not going to get any better. In the world, you shall have tribulation, tests and trials. But be of good cheer, I've overcome the world. So we can remain overcomers even in a totally chaotic world. But it's going to take knowing some things, some principles that will never change. And one of the early principles that most of you learned is the power of your words. And I find that more of a serious issue today among Word of Faith people, charismatic people. They quit watching what they say. One lady told me, you mean, Brother Jerry, after me preaching along there, you mean to tell me we got to go back and watch what we say? I said, lady, why'd you ever quit? This is not like algebra in junior high.
Right. That's right.
Anybody remember algebra? I hated algebra. I could see absolutely no use for algebra. But I had to take it in the ninth grade. And my algebra teacher knew I hated it. His name was Mr. Nichols. And Mr. Nichols came to me one day and he said, Jerry, you're going to have to learn this. You're going to need it for the rest of your life. I thought, liar, liar, pants on fire. I'm not going to need this for the rest of my life. If I pass this course, I'm going to throw that book just as far as I can throw it and never pick it up again. And then I got in high school and had to take Algebra 2. Then I started college, and I went to college to play baseball. That's the only reason I went, just to play baseball. And I had to take Algebra again. I thought, dear Lord, Mr. Nichols might have been right. And finally, I got past algebra. Then I had two daughters. And Jerry Ann, my oldest daughter, came to me one day and said, Daddy, I don't understand algebra. Can you help me? I said, give me the book. Had to read the whole book before I could help her with the problems that night. I could hardly wait till she got home the next day to see if I passed. And I did. Now, Terry was always good at math. I never had to help her in math. She was always good at math. But then they started having children. Papa, can you help me with algebra? Give me the book. Had to read the book again and work the problems. And my grandson, Preston, he struggled with algebra. And I had to read the book and help him that night. I could hardly wait till he got home to see if I passed again. And then once the grandchildren got past algebra, now I got great-grandchildren. They're not quite ready for algebra. They're not old enough yet. But if the Lord tarries, one of my great-granddaughters will come up and say, Papa, can you help me with algebra? I found out Mr. Nichols was right. I'm going to need it for the rest of my life. Well, you're going to need these basic principles for the rest of your life. You're going to need the revelation of the power of your tongue for the rest of your life. It's not something you learn one day and then put it aside and say, let's move on to something new. One person even told me, Brother Jerry, we're past that revelation about the power of words. We're into something deeper. I said, sir, it don't get any deeper than your mouth. Amen. And that's the problem that a lot of Christians are having today. They've quit guarding their vocabulary. They're talking CNN instead of WORD. Amen. So, what did he say? Continue in the things which you've learned. Did anybody learn about the power of words? Are you still practicing that? You'd be surprised at the number of Christians who've let go of it and then wondering, why am I struggling all the time? Why can't I overcome? Well, Jesus said, by your words you're justified, by your words you're condemned, snared by the words of your mouth. It all begins with the mouth. Amen. Amen. So we ought to pay much closer attention than ever to the things we have heard. The Message translation says it's crucial that we keep a firm grip on what we've heard.
That's right.
It's crucial.
Yeah.
Amen.
Yeah.
Crucial. Everybody say crucial.
Crucial.
The Passion translation says, be all the more engaged in the truths that you've heard.
Yeah.
And the word engaged means attached to, fixed to, holding tightly to.
Wow. So good.
So what is it saying? The basic principles that we've all learned, some of us a long time ago, some of you maybe over just the last few years. I'm sure that you've learned these basic principles going to this church. And he says it's crucial that you hold firm to them. You hold tightly to them. You're going to need them more in the coming days than you've ever needed them before. Can you say amen? Look at your neighbor and say, I hope you're listening. He's preaching to you. Now, Titus chapter 1, verse 9 says, hold fast to the faithful word as you have been taught. Hold fast to the faithful word as you have been taught. The Message translation says, having a good grip on the message, knowing how to use the truth. A firm grip on the message, knowing how to use the truth. Jesus said in Matthew chapter 7 from the New International Version, everyone who hears these words of mine and puts them into practice is like a wise man who built his house on the rock.
Yeah.
Now, if you remember that chapter, Jesus talked about two men, two different persons. One was a hearer of the word only. The other was a doer of the word.
So
the hearer of the word, Jesus said, he was like a man who built his house on the sand.
Yeah.
And when the storm came and beat vehemently against his house, great was the ruin.
Yeah.
But then the man who was not just a hearer, but a doer of the word, practiced it, lived by it, held fast to it, said he built his house on a rock. And that same storm that blew the other man's house away came to his house and couldn't shake it.
Hallelujah.
Couldn't shake it.
Hallelujah.
Why? Because he had built his foundation on the basic principles from the Word of God. Amen. My wife's father was a builder, and he built beautiful homes all over Shreveport, Louisiana. And one summer, while I was in college and Carol and I had just started dating, he asked me to help him on a job. And I didn't know anything about building houses. I grew up working on cars. My dad started teaching me how to work on cars when I was 9 years old. And what my dad didn't know about working on cars, they hadn't invented yet. But I didn't know a thing. I didn't know one piece of lumber from another. I didn't know one nail from another. I said, Roland, I'd be happy to help you, but I don't know what good I could be to you. He said, well, you can just be a gopher. I said, what's a gopher? He said, go for this, go for that, you know. I said, if I need this, I'll tell you, go get it, you know. And sometimes you can go to the store and get a salt of Coke or something, you know. So I was just there to help him. And he was starting a new house. And, of course, we're driving the stakes for the foundation. And he put that sledgehammer in my hand. And I drove stakes all day long. And I got a revelation by dark. I do not want to be a builder of houses. They had to pry my hands off that sledgehammer. Some of the skin on my hands stuck to the sledgehammer. And so the next day, they came and they poured the slab. And then the next day, we came in and took all the forms away. And he said, all right, gentlemen, it's time to begin the framing. He's going to start building the house. Now, the first thing I noticed was he didn't say, all right, guys, let's get those sledgehammers back and bust up all this concrete. We ought to build a house. No, you build the house on the foundation.
Amen. Yeah, that's right.
The house is only as good as the foundation.
Right. Yeah.
Amen. So we broke the forms away and started building the house, and it turned out to be a beautiful house. Amen. Well, that's exactly what Jesus is saying. You don't ever destroy the foundation. You keep building on it. You keep building. Everything you learn from your pastor, it should be building, continuing to build on that foundation. Can you say amen?
Amen?
So once again, Paul is saying it is crucial that you hold fast to the things that you've learned. And when are you going to need them the most? In perilous times.
Yes.
Times of great stress and trouble that are hard to deal with and hard to bear. Okay?
So
now, that's my introduction. Are you ready for the sermon?
Yes. Amen.
I cannot preach without talking about the favor of God.
Hallelujah.
So what I want to finish this message up with is favor in troubled times.
Hallelujah.
Favor in troubled times. Now, I've mentioned to you that I came to the Lord in 1969 through the ministry of Kenneth Copeland. And then Brother Copeland talked about Kenneth Hagin so often, I learned about Kenneth Hagin's ministry. I already knew about Oral Roberts' ministry. And then I had learned about T.L. and Daisy Osborne's ministry. So through their resources, these men became my four mentors. Okay. But I'd never heard one of them, not one of them, ever mention the favor of God. I didn't even know it existed. I'd never heard a sermon. I never read a book where anybody talked about the favor of God. And one morning, I'd get up at 6 o'clock every morning. And the Lord had told me, if you will give me 3 months, no less than 8 hours a day, studying my word, at the end of 3 months, I'll make a preacher out of you. He said, give me the same dedication you gave to that business. And in 3 months, you'll be in ministry. And you'll have a foundation on my word. So one morning I got up at 6 o'clock. I got up every morning and I'd go into my guest bedroom and I'd spend until noon. I'd come out and have lunch with my family. Then I'd go back in at 1 o'clock and I'd stay in there till 5 o'clock, come out and have dinner with my family, do whatever they wanted me to do the rest of the day. When they went to bed, I went back in there and my 8 hours a day turned into 10, 12, 15 hours a day. Because that's what I did in my business. If it took me all day and all night to finish a customer's car, to have it ready for him tomorrow, it didn't bother me at all. Just be up there all night. So, and the Lord said, give me that same dedication. So one morning, I got up and the Lord had instructed me to keep a journal on everything he said to me. Okay. And this is when I first began.
Yeah.
So I had a journal and every time the Lord would say something to me, I'd write the date and what he said to me in that journal. Now I have 54 years of journals in my archives. of things that God said to me over these years, okay? So this one morning, he said, get your journal out and write this down. He said, I'm going to teach you how to walk in my favor. And there will come a day I'll hold you responsible for teaching others how to walk in it as you do. And then he said this, and there will come a time that your name and ministry will be known all over the world for the favor of God that's on your life and on your ministry. Okay? So I wrote all that down. Now, my wife, once again, she'd been filled with the Holy Spirit since she's 8 years old. I'm less than 3 months old in the Lord when the Lord said this to me. You don't go into someone who's been living, you know, experiencing this full gospel message that she referred to it and tell her when you've only been saved less than 3 months. I never told a soul about it. I mean, you don't go to church that next Sunday and say, guess what, people? Come touch me.
Yeah.
I'm going to be known all over the world for the... Yeah. I never told a soul. Never told a soul. But God began to teach me about favor. And I began seeing it on every page.
Yeah.
And he said, now, this will become what he said to me was your signature message. He said, if you remember Kenneth Hagin's signature message was, when I raised him up from a deathbed, I told him, teach my people faith. And that's what he taught his entire life. When he raised up Oral Roberts, he said, take healing to your generation. That's what Brother Roberts preached his entire life. Brother Copeland, he taught the laws of prosperity. I don't know anybody that knows more about the spiritual laws of prosperity than Kenneth Copeland. That's his signature message. Billy Graham, if you ever heard Billy Graham, decision, decision. That's his signature message. Decision, make a decision. T.L. and Daisy Osborne, world evangelism. Every sermon's about world evangelism.
Yeah.
For me, my signature message is the favor of God.
Hallelujah.
And I've taught it all over the world. And I'm not being braggadocious, but I'm confident to say that I don't think there's any other preacher in our generation who's preached more sermons, written more resources, and provided more material on the subject of favor than I have. Okay? And over a period of time, that's exactly what happened, as Eric said. I get introduced most of the time in churches I go to, let's welcome Brother Favor. Let's welcome Dr. Favor.
Yeah.
Let's welcome Mr. Favor.
Yeah.
Did you know there was even a hip-hop artist wrote a song about me and the favor of God?
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
Have you heard it?
Yeah.
His name is Terry Minor, and it's called The Favor Flow. You can check it out on YouTube.
Yeah.
Terry Minor, The Favor Flow.
Yeah.
Now, I've never been into hip-hop, but I like this one. And I'm trying to learn the moves, you know. And in the song, at the beginning of it, he says, I want favor like Jerry Savelle.
Yeah. Ooh, right. Yeah. That's right.
Amen.
Amen.
And he wants favor like Jerry Savelle so badly, he moved to Fort Worth, is in our church, just so he can be around me and have favor like Jerry Savelle.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
He said, give me the favor flow. Give me the favor flow. I want favor just like Jerry Savelle. Carolyn said, you're not doing that right. I said, I'm better than you at it. She said, let Terry do the moves. You just enjoy the song. Okay. But what songs are they writing about you?
Yeah. Come on.
You picked a fine time to leave me, Lucille. Is that what they know?
Yeah.
I mean, it's certainly evident that when they write songs about the favor of God on your life.
Yeah.
Somebody's noticing, amen? So, with that said, what about favor in troubled times?
Glory to God.
Favor in troubled times. I do not leave my house without declaring the favor of God on my life. And you ask these guys that travel with me, and anybody that knows me well, I experience the favor of God in some way every day of my life before the sun goes down. Not every once in a while. Every day of my life.
Hallelujah.
Every day of my
Hallelujah.
life. Amen. And God's no respecter of persons. You have access to it just as much as I do. The only difference in me and perhaps some of you, I know more about it. But you can learn. And you can flow in it and walk in it. And live in it the same way I do. But it's such a deep revelation to me that I expect it to manifest every day of my life. Just like Eric was talking about when he mentioned the resources. During COVID, now, the Lord told me in those early days, actually New Year's Eve, January the 1st, 1970, an old prophet of God prophesied over me and said that I would not be able to fulfill what I was called to do without airplanes in my ministry. And the Lord said, you don't need them now, but start believing for them now. And believe for them debt-free. I don't want you to fly airplanes with debt on them. And he said, and when you need them, they'll be there. Now, that was 1970, January the 1st, when that word came to me. Well, I received my first debt-free airplane the latter part of 1975. That was 10 debt-free airplanes ago. Okay?
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
And God honored what he said. But I began launching out in international outreach in 1978. And so I was traveling all over the world. Now, the airplanes I was flying at the time, none of them could take me beyond the U.S., Canada, and, you know, some of the South American countries. But I was in international ministry. So I started believing God for an international aircraft.
Yeah.
And I learned a long time ago, there's no such thing as a harvest without sowing seeds. So every time I'd outgrow an airplane, I'd sow it into somebody else's ministry where it met their need and believe God for my next one. And every time God would put me in a bigger, better, faster airplane. Okay? Now, during COVID, I mean, like Eric said, he's heard me say that. Wouldn't it be just like God when the rest of the world is screaming worst of times, I'm having my best of times?
Yeah.
I call that favor.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. One of my partners called me and said, Brother Jerry, I don't know anything about airplanes, but I've heard you talk about airplanes many times. And he said, and I've had the privilege of flying in some of your airplanes. He said, and you've talked about a Falcon 50. He said, I heard there's a Falcon 50 in San Marcos, Texas, that's sitting in a hangar there. I don't know if it's for sale or not. I just felt in my spirit to call you and just let you know about it. Maybe you'd want to send your chief pilot down there and check it out. So I told my chief pilot, Brad, I said, Brad, check it out and see if there's a Falcon 50 in a hangar in San Marcos. He called down there and found out, yes, it'd been sitting there for about 6 months. And the owner was a businessman in Houston and said, and it is for sale. So I said, well, let's arrange to go down there and take a look at it tomorrow. So we got in the citation that I have, and we flew down there, and the broker had it out on the tarmac so we could climb up in it. Beautiful airplane, low time on it, and hadn't been flown in 6 months. And so I said, well, tell the broker to step outside and shut the door. You get up in the cockpit and pray. I'm going to walk around in the cabin back here and pray. If you get anything from God, tell me. If I get anything from the Lord, I'll tell you. And let's find out if it's my airplane.
Yeah.
So we're praying. I could hear him up in the cockpit praying. I'm walking back in the cabin, back and forth, praying. And all of a sudden, the joy of the Lord come on me. I'm telling you, it hit me big time. And I heard it hit Brad up in the cockpit. Man, we're jumping and shouting and praising God. I said, Brad, get back here. This is my airplane. He said, I know it is, Brother Jerry. I said, joy is a fruit of the Spirit. This came from God.
Hallelujah.
I said, tell the broker to get back up here and I'm going to buy this airplane. I'm going to buy this airplane. Didn't have the dime to pay for it.
Yeah.
Well, what's new?
Yeah.
Adventures in faith. That's what I call it.
Amen.
And so, as he was getting the broker, the Lord said to me, tell him you'll pay what he's asking for. Don't negotiate. I said, Lord, that's not the way we do business down here. I said, I have never paid what they've asked for an airplane. it's always negotiable.
Yeah.
I said, why would I not want to negotiate? He said, because I'll make it up to you on the end. Just be obedient to me. So by the time the broker got up there, I said, sir, I believe this is my airplane. I'll pay you what you're asking for it, and let's work up a contract. He said, you don't want to negotiate? I wanted to say, yeah, but God wouldn't let me, you know. But I didn't say a word. And so we went into a pre-buy. Now, I have to back up a little bit because I mentioned I don't borrow money for anything, and particularly not airplanes, because God said, I don't want you ever flying airplanes with debt on them. But I don't have the money that it costs to get in this airplane debt-free. But the Lord had blessed me with a piece of property that I bought 40 years ago for nickels on the dollar, you know, I mean. And it had all of a sudden increased in value because Fort Worth was coming our way. And I just held on to that property. Turns out a broker, a developer came and offered me for that property what this airplane cost. Okay? So we went into pre-buy. And, of course, if you know anything about aviation, you don't buy an airplane without going into pre-buy. Make sure all the inspections are current. So we got into the pre-buy, and I put up $500,000 for the pre-buy. And they started finding out that there were four major inspections that were past due. I said, well, sir, you can't really sell this airplane with those inspections past due because you didn't say it was for sale as is. So you're required by the FAA to get these inspections taken care of before you can sell it. Now, I will pay you what you're asking for it, but you got to take care of these inspections. Now, remember the Lord told me, don't negotiate. I'll make it up to you on the end. So I don't know what that means, but I'm just trusting God here. The first inspection was $250,000. The owner had to pay for it. The second inspection was $125,000. The owner had to pay for it. The third inspection was right at $100,000. The owner had to pay for it. Let's see. How much is that now?
Wow.
Anybody adding?
$475,000.
$475,000, okay. That they had to pay before I even bought the airplane. Okay. Then the owner said, tell Mr. Savelle if he wants that airplane, I am not paying for that last inspection. He'll have to pay for it. I said, no problem. I'll pay for it. He said, but also tell him I'll knock $250,000 off the asking price. Okay. He's already spent $475,000. He knocks $250,000 off. So that means I'm getting the airplane for what now? Does anybody know how to add in here?
You got $725 off.
$725,000 off. Okay. So we buy it and we pay cash for it with what I got out of that piece of property. Okay. Now, I don't think, well, we didn't give them a picture of it. But anyway, if you see on the tail of the airplane, I requested a N number that I wanted as a testimony to the favor of God and the faithfulness of God. And if you look on the airplane, it's November 920 Juliet Sierra, which means Juliet Sierra, JS, Jesus Saves, or Jerry Savelle, whatever you want. And the November, of course, that's on every airplane in America. But the 9 represents September, and the 20 is 2020. I wanted it to be a testimony everywhere we go that God made this happen through His favor on my life and ministry in a pandemic. Hallelujah. When everybody's screaming, worst of times, I'm having my best of times. I call that favor, amen? Go ahead and touch me, it'll get on you. Hallelujah. Now, that's the way I live every day of my life. Yeah, there it is. Look, 920 Juliet Sierra. Okay? Now, I can go anywhere in the world in that.
Hallelujah.
Oh, hallelujah. We flew to Europe in it not too long ago.
Glory to God.
We fly 42,000 feet everywhere we go.
Hallelujah.
We had such good tailwinds. We were flying 620 miles an hour in that plane, arriving an hour early everywhere we went, praise God. It's been a great airplane.
Hallelujah.
But that's a testimony to the favor of God.
Yes.
Now, I know most of you don't need airplanes for what you do, but I can't do what I'm called to do without them. Now, somebody said, are you too good to fly commercial airline? No, I'm not. I'd like to ask if there's anybody else in here who has from one airline, American Airlines, a card that indicates that you have flown on that one airline 4.5 million miles. Anybody else have one of those? I do. That's one airline I've flown, 4.5 million miles. So I'm not too good to fly commercial.
Yeah, that's right.
But I don't have to. Amen. I don't have to. Glory to God. God honored his word. You'll not be able to fulfill what you're called to do without airplanes. And the favor of God has produced every airplane I've ever owned. Amen. I outgrow them. I sow them into some other ministry. And God blesses me with bigger, better, and faster. One time, Jesse and I were doing a meeting in Augusta together. And after the meeting, I was going to take him to New Orleans, drop him off. And then I'm flying on to Fort Worth. So we got out to the airport, and my pilot said, guys, we can't take off right now. There's some storms in the area, and we're going to have to wait for a window to open so we can take off. And it'd probably be about an hour. So just go sit in the FBO. So we sat in there, and he came and said, guys, we've got to get on the airplane right now. We've got a small window, but we can get out of here. It's safe. But if we wait any longer, it'll be tomorrow before we can leave. So we went to get on the airplane, and Jesse said, Jerry, you want me to set up in the cockpit and help him? I said, no, Jesse, I don't want you sitting in the cockpit. I want you to sit on the toilet in the back and don't touch anything back there either. I said I wasn't going to pick on Jesse, but I just can't help it. I know he is in Kerrville tonight. And if you watch the message, he's picking on me. So I got to get my licks in too, okay?
Yeah. Yeah.
He's a funny guy. So notice here, the favor of God in troubled times. If it worked for me, why wouldn't it work for you? God's no respecter of persons. Psalm 5, verse 12, very quickly. For thou, Lord, will bless the righteous, and with favor thou will compass him as with a shield. Another translation says, you will surround him like a shield. Hallelujah.
Glory to God.
I dare you to go to work tomorrow and just walk in your place of work and do it like this.
Yeah. Glory to God.
And when somebody asks, what are you doing? Just tell them, you should have been in church last night.
That's right.
See, you have access to the favor of God surrounding you. Amen. Surrounding you everywhere you go. I've got this magnetic field that follows me everywhere I go. Everywhere I go. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Things happen to me in a day that doesn't happen to most people in a lifetime. Because I believe for the favor of God. And you're going to need it more now than ever before. Can you say amen?
Amen?
Job chapter 10 verse 12 says, thou hast granted me life and favor, and thy visitation hath preserved my spirit. You've granted me life and favor.
Hallelujah.
Now you remember at the beginning of the book of Job, he's the richest man in all the East. And then the trouble came. Okay? And the Bible says that throughout all that Job experienced, and just remember this now, the book of Job does not cover his entire life. Most theologians say between 9 and 12 months.
Yeah.
Okay? But it's the worst 9 to 12 months you ever read about.
Yeah.
But notice here, during that 12 months, he went through more adversity than anybody you've ever read about.
Yeah.
But he says, you have granted me life and favor.
Glory to God.
Amen. Yeah. Knowing that you have favor in the worst of times will preserve you. Hallelujah.
Glory to God.
That's what he said.
That's right.
You've granted me life and favor, and it has preserved my spirit. The word preserve your spirit means your spirit, even though you've got trouble all around you, your spirit's not crushed. It's not suppressed. Amen. You're able to remain faithful when most people are giving up. And we know the end of the story. God turned it all around for him. And notice the favor of God on his life not only brought him out of that crisis, but he blessed him twice what he'd lost. Amen. That's what the favor of God will do. I was excited when I came to the Lord and I found out that God was in the restoration business. I didn't know that. I was in the restoration business. I restored classic cars. People bring their old classic cars into my shop in baskets and on trailers with just pieces. Jerry, make this look like it came out of the factory when Henry Ford built it in 1927. So my definition of restoration or restore was bring back to original condition. Okay? But when I found out God restores, he never brings back to original condition. He improves. He makes better. He increases. He multiplies. He will never bring you back to original condition. Amen. He will make Satan wish he had never attacked you. Hallelujah. He will take what Satan meant for bad and turn it into something good. And that's exactly what he did for Job. Job lost everything he had, but God turned it all around and blessed him with twice as much as he had. That's what the favor of God will do. Look at your neighbor and say, thank God for favor. Amen. Now, let me close it with this. Go with me to Psalm 102. I'm not finished. I don't ever get finished. I just have to find a place to stop. Psalm 102. And look at verse 12. Are you there?
Yes, sir.
Pages are sticking together. Psalm 102 and begin in verse 12. But thou, O Lord, shalt endure forever in thy remembrance unto all generations. Thou shalt arise and have mercy upon Zion, for the time to favor her, yea, the set time is come. Now, Zion is significant or symbolic of the church, the body of Christ. And notice here it says, for the time to favor her, the body of Christ, has come. The set time has come. Another translation says, the appointed time. Now, when is the set time? When is the appointed time? Was the psalmist the only one who experienced this? Or is that something that you and I can experience? If you go to the heading right under the Psalm 102 in most Bibles, it's in my Bible. Anybody else in their Bible so they'll know that I'm not making this up? A prayer of the afflicted when he was overwhelmed. Does anybody else have that?
Yes, sir.
Now notice, he is praying when he is overwhelmed. Troubled. Okay? But he remembers that every time God's people were experiencing trouble, God manifested his favor in their behalf. For instance, the children of Israel in Egypt. What did God say through Moses to the people? I will show this people favor. I will show this people favor. That's in Exodus chapter 3. Exodus chapter 12, it says, and God showed the people favor. Not only did he deliver them from their captivity, but he restored unto them everything that had belonged to them and the previous generations before them. 400 years of restoration took place in that one generation.
Glory to God.
He told them, I will give this people favor, and he said, go and borrow from the Egyptians the silver and the gold.
Wow.
Now these were their taskmasters.
Wow.
Can you imagine this Israelite knocking on the Egyptian's door and said, God told me to come and borrow all your gold and silver.
Wow.
Now stand right here, go get it. And these Egyptians went, okay. And they went and got all the gold and the silver. And they did that throughout that area.
Yeah.
And when they marched out with the gold and the silver.
Yeah.
Notice God not only delivered them out of their bondage, but he paid them back everything that had been stolen for 400 years.
Hallelujah.
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 And then, of course, you know the rest of the story. They get to the Red Sea. And now the children of Israel think Moses has deceived them. He brought us out here to die. God tells Moses what to do. He splits the Red Sea. They go across on dry ground. The Egyptian army decided to follow them. And when they went into the Red Sea that had been opened by God, he closed it up and swallowed them.
Yeah. Hallelujah.
And it's the first recording in the Bible of supernatural debt cancellation.
Hallelujah.
Amen. They borrowed from the Egyptians, and God erased their debt by swallowing up those that they owe.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. I'm telling you, the favor of God is an amazing thing. I'll close with this. Do yourself a favor and study favor. Do yourself a favor and study favor, because you're going to need it now in these perilous times like never before. Favor will open doors that no man can shut. Favor will change rules and regulations and policies in your behalf.
Amen.
Favor will give you preferential treatment. You got time for one more story? About 1981, I was in South Africa, and I was in the Zulu village preaching to the Zulus. And the chief invited me into his hut, and we're sitting on a dirt floor, a hut so dark I can hardly see my hand in front of my face. And of course he's dark, and I can see the whites of his eyes and his teeth. And he's sitting across from me, and I have a translator. And when I walked in the hut, he told me to sit down on the dirt floor with him. He sat across from me. And he said through my translator, he said, ask him where he gets his power. So I told the translator, tell him from the Holy Spirit. Then I asked the translator, ask him where he gets his power. He said, evil spirits. And then he said, through the translator, tell him his power is greater than my power. He said, and I want to know his God. So I led him to the Lord there in that little hut. So in a little while, he gets up and goes, I can hardly see him. He gets up and he walks away, and then he comes back. And he brings back an ancestral spear that had been passed down from one generation to another. Now in Africa, particularly back a long time ago, this spear represented authority. There are many tribes in Africa. Weak tribes, strong tribes.
Yeah.
Weak tribes want to go into covenant with strong tribes.
Right.
And he was part of a strong tribe. And this spear had been handed down from his ancestors, great-grandfathers, grandfathers, fathers. And it was a very special spear, because when his ancestors walked through their part of Africa holding that spear, it represented they were people of authority. So he gives me that spear as a gift. He wants me to have it. And so, I mean, this is a precious thing to me.
Yeah.
You know, I've been given things like that in Africa when I preach to different tribes. And some of them, monetarily, they're not worth anything, but they're worth something to me because it was worth something to them.
Yeah.
I have little trinkets, you know, that they made out of mud that I wouldn't take $1 million for.
Right.
They're all in my archives. And so he gives me this spear. Now I have to go to Cape Town to fly to Joburg, and from Joburg to London, and from London to JFK, New York City, and from JFK to DFW with my spare. And I don't want to put it in the cargo because it's too valuable.
Right.
It might get broken in there.
Right.
So I check my cargo, I mean my luggage in on the street, and I walk up to the counter with my spare. And the lady says, you can't take that on board. Oh, I said, you don't understand. This is very valuable, very, very precious. She said, I don't care how precious it is. That's a weapon. You can't take it on board. I said, I'll put it in the overhead, and I won't take it out until I get to my destination. No, that won't work. You can't do that. Well, about that time, I said, under my breath, you know, where she didn't hear me, I said, Lord, this would be a wonderful opportunity for favor to kick in. Okay? So I'm standing there with my spear, and she's arguing with me. Somebody tapped me on the shoulder. I turn around, and it's a captain for South African Airlines. He said, what flight are you on? I told him, he said, that's my flight. I'm the captain. He said, give me your spear. I'll put it in the cockpit, and I'll give it to you when we get to Joburg.
Hallelujah.
My spear had a better seat than I did. And I had a good seat, but it's in the cockpit.
Hallelujah.
So when we get to Joburg, the captain's standing there with my spear, gives it to me, and I go to the, you know, to get my boarding pass with my spear, and I go through the same thing. You can't carry that spear on there. Somebody tapped me on the shoulder. Where are you going? I said, I'm going to London. Are you flying British Air? Yes. What flight number? I told him, I'm the captain on that flight. Give me your spear. I'll put it in the cockpit with me. My spear flew all the way from Joburg to London in the cockpit. I get to London. I go to the counter with my spear. And I got to fly to JFK. Same thing. You can't take that spear aboard. Turn around, American Airlines pilot. What flight are you on? I told him, he said, that's my flight. I'll put it up in the cockpit. My spear flew to JFK in the cockpit. Lord. Same thing happened when I got to JFK. My spear flew from Cape Town all the way to DFW in the cockpit. And when I got out of DFW, I said, folks, that's what the favor of God will do. Hallelujah. Amen. Now, there are some of you, maybe many of you, that are going through situations right now. In the natural, they look impossible. In the natural, you don't know what to do. You've run out of options. Maybe it's a time, maybe it's time for you to start believing for the favor of God.
Hallelujah.
And I just say it this way, it's maybe, you know, just layman terminology. Time for the favor of God to kick in.
Yeah, that's right.
Look at your neighbor and say,
it is time
for the favor of God to kick in. And in the words, to manifest. Amen. So I want you to stand to your feet, if you will. And I want to pray over you. And I trust that what you've heard tonight has been a blessing to you, inspired your faith. Praise God. Hallelujah. There's some things that I wrote down in a meeting I was in Canada recently that the Lord said to me, and I want to read it to you as we prepare to pray for you. Let me find it. I marked it somewhere. There it is. Nope. Where is that? I thought I had, there it is. Now listen to this. This was just a couple of weeks ago in Canada. This word from the Lord came, and I had my secretary transcribe it. God is ready for you to experience new things, things which you have never experienced before. But the question is, will you receive it by faith?
Yes.
Will you decree it in faith?
Yes.
Will you expect it to happen for you? And will you prepare to receive it?
Yes.
Your response to these questions will determine just how much of it will happen for you.
Yes.
Even though at this moment, you may not be able to see how God could do this for you. You must remember that He's the God in whom nothing is impossible. And He's the God who can make a way where there seems to be no way. Even though your adversary, the devil, will attempt to prevent it from happening to you and for you, he's not mightier than the God you serve. Simply make the decision that you will stay close to God, stay full of His Word, remain in faith, and you'll see that your God is still the God of wonders. He's still the God of miracles. He's still the God that can make things happen that you could never make happen. He's still the God that hears your cry, and He's still the God that answers your prayer. His hand has not been shortened, and His power has not been diminished. Remember this. Just because you can't see anything happening doesn't mean that it's not happening. He's always working behind the scenes, and He's always working on surprises that will manifest in your life if you will continue to stay in faith. Don't lean to your own understanding. Do not try to figure it out on your own and in your own mind. He's more than capable. He will not disappoint you. Don't limit Him by thinking small. Don't confine Him to how He's made things happen to you in the past. This is a new day, and He's going to do it in a new way. Will you receive it by faith? Will you declare it in faith? Will you expect it? And will you prepare for it? If your answer is yes, so be it in Jesus' name. Come on, let's give Him a shout of praise. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Amen, amen. So lift your hands right now. And Father, I pray over every person within the sound of my voice. And I pray that the word that they've heard tonight has lodged deeply in their hearts. Satan, I forbid you to steal it from them. And I believe that if they will hold fast to it, Jesus said it will produce as much as 100-fold in return. And Lord, I'm asking you to cause your favor to flow down in and on them beyond their wildest imaginations. May this be the day that they experience your favor like never before. May they be able to say, had it not been for the favor of God, I don't know where I'd be. So in Jesus' name, I believe there is a release of favor taking place in the spirit realm right now, taking them to a higher level in the favor of God than they've ever experienced before, in the mighty name of Jesus. Now, let me close it with this. This is my second closing. I love closing. I learned that from the Apostle Paul. He said, finally, my brethren, and then wrote a whole nother chapter. Listen to what Paul said in 1 Timothy chapter 1. I'm reading it from the Message translation first. I'm so grateful to Christ for making me adequate to do this work. Grace mixed with faith and love poured over me and unto me, all because of Jesus. Now, if you look in your Amplified Bible, most of the time when you see the word grace in parentheses, it will say unmerited favor. So grace and favor are synonymous. Okay, now listen to this from the Amplified. Same verse. And the grace, the unmerited favor and blessing of the Lord, actually flowed out. Now, here's what I'm believing for you tonight. Listen to this. Actually flowed out super abundantly and beyond measure for me, accompanied by faith and love. So I'm praying that the favor of God, which you already have a measure of, you got a measure of when you got born again. But notice, it can increase. You remember the times that Paul and Peter both would end a chapter, grace be multiplied unto you. Favor be multiplied unto you. Okay? So I'm praying in Jesus' name that the favor of God you will begin to experience from this night forward super abundantly and beyond measure. Hallelujah. And somebody say, I receive it. I said, somebody say, I receive it. And give the Lord your best shout. Pastor. Amen.
Hallelujah. Praise God. By grace, by His divine favor, we were saved. Amen. Hallelujah. Glory to God. What a great message. What an exciting thing to know that we've been given everything we need to do everything we need to do. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Come on up if you would. You can sing us out here in just a moment. Before we are dismissed, let me ask you very quickly. First of all, we got a lot of stuff going out of here. But let me give you an opportunity if you're with us tonight. And you've never personally received the Lord Jesus. That favor is here for that to happen. As a matter of fact, I don't believe there's anything more important on the Father's agenda than everyone be saved. And there is no reason why anybody would want to turn down the truth of God's Word when He was willing to give His Son so that we could have everlasting life. It's a spiritual transaction. You know, just like Dr. Jerry said, the last thing you want to do is use your pea brain to reason or to figure out the things of God. They are spiritual. They are not carnal. They're not flesh. They're not intellect. They are supernatural. And you have to choose life. And it's the biggest choice you make that is the one that takes you out of death and into life spiritually. You actually have no idea what you're doing. You have detached yourself from all reason, huh? It sounds like a lot of people in the world, except the bottom line is they are blinded. That's what happens when you don't know. But once you receive Him, once the favor of God connects with your heart, once you become a new creation, all of a sudden God is able to work on your behalf through your heart with His Word so that you can walk, live, and enjoy the favor of God. And again, what we hear tonight is what we need to hear, just like a message on confession. We need to keep these principles where they belong. We need to think about them, meditate on them, and talk about them day after day after day. Many of us have already had enough years in life to realize the world has nothing to offer us. The only thing that we have access to is the supernatural power of the Creator. So before we're dismissed, before we sing our way out of here, before you get an opportunity to check your tickets to see if you won something, what about your eternity? What about your eternal life? You know, the Lord spoke to me. It's been several years now. He said, I want you to tell all the believers that their last breath will be their best breath. And when you know that, it takes all the fear out of your heart and mind. Because when you know Him, those eyelids will close, they'll flip open immediately, and you'll be in His presence. I can assure you, once you become a child of God, you'll begin to gain confidence. You'll begin to know in whom you have believed, just like Paul said. And you'll be persuaded that He's able to keep you an overcomer through hard times, smooth times, good days, and better days because of your relationship with Him. So let me ask you if that's you. If that's you tonight, this could be a real special night for you. The 12th of April, is it? 2024. This would be a perfect time, praise God, for you to step out of darkness and into light. To not be concerned about that. So as they just play softly, if that's you, Jesus said, if you will confess me before men, I will confess you before my Father. He wasn't ashamed to die stark naked in front of a world. And we should not be ashamed either. It's the most exciting thing to do, to step into the kingdom of God. I wish there was some way we could make it more exciting other than just tell you. It's the greatest thing that's ever happened to those of us who have allowed it to happen. It's a supernatural thing. If that's you, just take a couple of moments. Walk out of right where you're standing. Don't think anything about it, because the only thing that the people around you will be is excited that your name has been sealed in the Lamb's Book of Life. The reservation's made. All he's asking you to do tonight is confirm what he already did before the foundation of the world. Do it tonight. The goodness of God is in the room for you to do it tonight. The goodness of God is in the room tonight. It's the goodness of God that draws man to a position of repentance. Not the severity, not his wrath, not his fear, his goodness. Everything we've heard tonight is a picture of his goodness. He's a good God. From the youngest to the oldest. If you know in whom you have believed, that's where you need to be. But if you don't, he wants you to know that it happens in a moment. Anyone at all? Anyone at all? Thank you, Father. Lord, we magnify you tonight. We're grateful for your goodness. Father, we thank you. We know what you've done for us. We know the opportunities you've given us. We know that you are our life and the very length of our days. And we bless you. Father, I pray that if any individual has any reservations at all about their eternity, that what they've heard tonight, the opportunity they've been given tonight, will take them to a place of repentance. Father, I thank you that there's nothing more important to you. It's not your will that any be lost. Your highest desire is that your Son be received. Thank you, Lord. Bless the Lord. Father, we thank you for your patience. We thank you for your patience. Thank you, Lord. So rebeshito tolobokora tatabasere beki. O remesito robokorana masoto roboko. Yo remesito roboko. O remesito roboko tatarabaka. O ramasa. The greatest step of faith you will ever take is receiving him. It'd have to be the greatest step of faith, because it's the greatest thing that we have set before us. He said, I have set before you life and death, blessing and cursing. Therefore, choose life. So that both you and your seed may live. And that you will love the Lord your God. You will obey him. You will cling to him. Because he is your life. You don't know anything about life until you receive His life. And He gives you that freely. And He becomes the length of your days. While the promises on long life. Because when His life is your life, it will be a long life. It will be a highly favored life. It will be the life that those of us that have rejoice in. Thank you, Father. We magnify you in this place. We are grateful for this great gift you have given us tonight. You have shown us a man of God who for 55 years has honored your word, continued to stay on the rock of revelation, and move forward, not willing to quit, not willing to give up, but to continue to preach the only thing that matters, the word of faith that we preach. Thank you, Father. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Are you ready to do what you need to do? Okay. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Praise God. Give us just a few more minutes. We're going to take a couple of opportunities to close that Dr. Jerry didn't take yet. So.
Yeah. Say the Lord is good. Amen.
Hallelujah.
And His mercy, His favor, it endures forever. Were you blessed tonight? I told Pastor Greg, I've never been so grateful to be in the household of faith than I am tonight. And we don't have anybody here that doesn't preach faith. We already know that. But there was something so special about tonight. And I'm so thankful for your hunger. And I'm so thankful for your presence. And for those of you that tuned in online, I encourage you to continue to listen. And we'll listen to this message again and again. I'll tell you right now, get the Favor of God book from the book table. That's going to be our book of the month for May. So those of you that read with us, just know that's going to be our book of the month in May. You can get it now or you can get it. We'll get it and have it for you. But isn't the Lord good? Aren't you grateful? I'm so grateful because in the words of my father-in-law, people, even in the church, have given themselves over to complete and total weirdness. And that will not be us.
Amen.
Right? We're staying as far away from weirdness. And if you just got in on this, hallelujah. You came in just in time. But if you've always been in this, I'm telling you, you're probably like me. I am so thankful. I am so thankful. And we refuse to let anything slip. Yeah. Right? We refuse. We're going all the way until we see Him face to face. Amen? Yeah. Amen. Well, we have a lot of jumpers, a lot of fun things. Okay, so the jumpers are going to be through the youth room where the after party is going to be taking place with the product table and all of that fun stuff. And then food trucks are out front. So food's out front, but all the fun stuff is in the back. And so get out your tickets. You don't have to stay seated. Just go ahead and stand up because you've been sitting for a long time if you'd like. Obviously, our gear, we want to show you that. If you haven't already had a chance to get Hobbs as it is in heaven, these are available. These are small sizes. Obviously, we have more sizes than just these. But if you haven't seen these are great. This is our new gear. So make sure that you take advantage of that. And then if you're a teenager, we're going to give away tonight a couple of products from our DSM product store. So we'll give those away first. So students, get out your tickets and we'll just do last three. Oh, you already got one? Perfect.
Go ahead.
No, go ahead.
All right. Last three, 2, 3, 9.
239. Teenager should have a red ticket. 239. All right. Next one.
267. Well, we got a delayed 239 or what? 267.
All right. 267. All right. Great, 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 great. All right.
Next winner. 271.
All right, Mario. Okay, and lastly, this is the last one, and this is like a singing machine.
Oh.
Wait, y'all have one more. One more from the DSM store. Okay, my bad.
All right, one more from the DSM store. Here we go. Last three, 233.
All right, now we have a singing machine.
All right, let's see who our next praise and worship person is going to be here. 2, 3, 6.
We barely know our numbers at a normal time, much less right before 10. Okay, nobody has that one? All right.
All right, here we go.
It's not those two.
The new singer is 2, 6, 5. Yes? No? Yes?
All right. Oh, wow.
Winner, winner.
That might be prophetic. All right, we'll leave that alone. We'll leave that alone.
All right, here we go.
Okay, so three gifts.
Adult, blue ticket. Last three, 4, 2, 4.
All right. Yes.
Next winner.
2, 4, 1. Last three, 2, 4, 1.
Oh, wait a minute, Miss Sylvia.
Awesome, Miss Sylvia. Last three, 4, 3, 3. 4, 3, 3. All right. Okay, now we're giving away, and they one person gets both of these, right? So it's a knife set, a ninja. It says never dull, y'all. So, and then a ninja blender. 418. Last three, 418. All right. Congratulations. Did you guys have an incredible time at this anniversary conference? Okay, well, don't sleep on the after party because there's a lot of fun to be had. So again, bouncers are in the back. So grab your kids. Food's in the front. There's food trucks in the front. We love you. We'll see you on Sunday, 8:45, 10:45. We're going to praise you out. If you were with us online, thank you so much. Don't forget to get your Favorite of God book and all the other great resources at Dr. Jerry Savelle's table located in the youth room. We love you guys. Good night.